Hello everyone, welcome to the Makri Virtual. Hope you are doing good. Today I am going to continue with your chapter number 9, and the topic for the today is dynamic memory allocation. In the last class we have covered multiple topics. In last class we have studied the file system or the Linux memory management and the Linux memory system and the memory mapping. And today's topic is the dynamic memory allocation. That is how dynamically memory will be allocated to the different processes. That is a dynamic memory allocation. So let's take a quick review what we have covered in the last class. That is, what is the lecture or what is the session for the last class. So let's have a look on the last class lecture, that is the previous class lecture. In the last class we have started with the chapter number 9, that is the virtual memory continued. We started with the Linux memory system, and that is, what is the Linux memory system and how address translation is done in the Linux memory system with the help of a different processors like i6, i7, p6, p4. These are the topics that is covered in this topic. We have started with the Intel P6, or we have covered the i7, any processor, but the memory management, but the designing is totally same. But the processor is different, although the processing is the same. So we have talked about the i7 and the Intel P6. This says it is the internal designation for the successor to the Pentium. That is, it is the internally used for the processor, that is for the coming P4 or P6, P7, that is a coming configuration processor. It is used for the memory allocation or the Linux operating system. Next point says fundamentally different from the Pentium. Why it is fundamentally different? Because it is a different processor, so everything is a different one. Resulting processors, that is, what is a resulting processor? Why we are using the P6? What is the main advantage of using the P6? So these are the topics that we have covered in this slide. Then we have covered about the memory system. This is the memory system of the P6, that is the Pentium 6. There is a dynamic RAM that is used. There is an external system bus, that is a external bus that is used for configuration, that is used for communication between the processor and the memory. There is a cache memory, there is a bus interface, L1 cache, L2 cache, cache memory. These are the abbreviations that is used in the Linux memory system. One is VPO, VPN. VPO means virtual page offset, and the virtual page number, that is the VPN. In the same way, TLBI, TLBT, TLB index, TLB tag. In the same way, components of the physical address has also abbreviations like PPO, PPN, CO, CI, CT. Then this is the overview of the P6 address translation, that is how address translation should be performed on the Pentium 6, that is a P6 address translation. This diagram shows that how address will be translated from the CPU to the dynamic RAM, that is from memory to the CPU. There is a CPU, there is a result, there is a L2 and the dynamic RAM. One is your physical address, one is your virtual address. So this is your page table that is used. This is a page table entry, this is your page data entries. Then TLB, that is your translation look aside buffer. This is the TLBI, TLBT. This is the physical address. So this shows how address is translated from virtual address to the physical address. Then P6 two-level page table structure. That is how two-level page table structure is used in the P6 or in the Linux operating system. Then P6 page table entry. That is your PTE, page table entries. That is used, that have a page physical base address, avail, G, O, D, A, C, D, WT, US, RV, P equals to 1. So these are the page table entries that is used. So one is avail that is use G D A C D W T U S read write P that is page is present or not. So these are the various entries that is used in the PTE. Then we also studied about the PDE, that is a page directory entry that is used. These are the abbreviations that is used. Then we also studied how P6 page tables map to the virtual address to the physical one. That is how page tables are used to convert the virtual address or the physical address into the virtual address, and the vice versa, that is converting of the virtual address into the physical address. This is the diagram that shows how physical or page table is used to map the virtual address into the physical one. Then we also studied how to represent the virtual address space, that is what is the how to represent or what is the representation of the virtual address in the memory. This says there is a page directory, there is a page table PT1, PT2, PT0. These are the multiple pages. That start from the 0 and end with the 15. So there are total 16 pages. Then P6 TLB translation. This is the P6 TLB translation, means how translation look aside buffer, that is TLB, is used for the translating the P6, that is your Pentium 6. This is the P6 TLB. There is a TLB entry that is not all documented, so this is speculative. This is V, this is PD, this is tag, this is PDE and the PTE. Then how to translate with the P6 TLB. Then P6 page table translation. So these are the slide that shows how translation or how memory translation should be done with the help of P6, with the help of the page table. Then translate with the P6 page table. That is a case one, that is how to translate the page table entries. Then we also studied the cache memory, that how to use the cache memory, what is the scenario, why we are using the cache memory. This is translating the P6 page table, that is that we also studied in the last class. Then we also studied how to use the P6 L1 cache. So this is the P6 L1 cache access, that is how to access the cache with or how to access the cache memory when we are using the P6 Linux memory system. This is the L1 cache access. This is the diagram that shows how how L1 cache memories exist. Then speed up the L1 cache. We also studied how to speed up the L1 cache with the help of the Linux memory system. Then how to organize or how Linux organized virtual memory as a collection of area, that is how virtual memory is divided into multiple chunks, into multiple segments. That is how Linux organizes or Linux arranges the VM or the virtual memory as a collection of the areas. There are different areas that is used. One is your shared libraries, data, text, PGD, that is a page directory address, VM port, that is a read-write permission that is used for the read-write permission, flag that is used for the indicator that indicates various bits like 0, 1. Then Linux page fault handling, that how page fault can be handled by the Linux memory system. Whenever the page is not available in the memory, that is known as the page fault, and it is a responsibility of the Linux to handle the page fault. So that is, or that process is known as the page fault handling, and that technology techniques is used as a Linux page fault handler, that is used to handle the fault or handle the page fault that is accessed or that is used. This says the Linux page fault handling is the VA legal that is used, that is the Linux page fault handling is used or indicates why or when the Linux page fault handling is done. Is the VA legal? So this is the question that arises, whether the page fault handling is legal or not. Is the operation legal? That is the operation that is performed is legal or not. Then we have studied the next topic, that is the memory mapping. This is one of the interesting topic that we have studied, that how memory mapping, that is how new VM area or the new virtual memory area is done or is created via the memory mapping. That is how we can map the virtual memory with the physical memory so that a new area can be generated for the virtual memory. That is the creation of the new VM area. Multiple function can be used for creating the new area, like create new VM area struct and the page table for the area. Area can be backed up, that is area can be used for regular files, for nothing, for dirty points or dirty pages. Then we have studied one technique, that is copy on write, that is used whenever there is a private copies of the same data, that is that needs the private rewritable copies of the same data. The solution is that make the separate copy in the memory, that is make the separate copy for the public as well as the private in the memory. Then we also studied about the user level memory mapping, that is how user level memory mapping is done, that is done by or that is used by the C function, that is mmap, that is your memory mapping. These are the C example that is used, these are the header file that is used. Then we have studied about the summary, that is what is memory system, how it is divided into multiple parts, what is cache memory, how cache memory is used, virtual memory, how virtual memory is used, and the combination of the hardware and the software implementations. So these are the topics that we have studied in the last class. Now let's take a quick review or let's take a topic for the today's class, that is a dynamic memory allocation. This is one of the important as well as the interesting topic that is available in C language, that is available in the any programming language or the operating system. That is a dynamic memory allocation. As the name advice, dynamic memory allocation, that is memory is allocated at the dynamic time. What is the dynamic time? When the CPU or the when the computer is processing anything or executing anything, that is known as the dynamic time. So memory is allocated at the allocated or memory is allocated to the different processes at the dynamic time, that is known as the dynamic memory allocation. This says while it is certainly possible to use the low level map mmap and the mun map, that is memory mapping and the mun mapping function, to create and delete virtual areas of the virtual memory. So this is used for creating a map memory, that is mmap. This is used for deleting a memory, that is a mun map. C programmer typically find it's more C programmer finds it more convenient and more portable to use a dynamic memory allocator when they need to acquire additional virtual memory at the runtime. So this says the C programming or the C programmer who writes the code, if they need the extra memory for storing their program, for using the pointers, for using the variable, so they use a dynamic memory allocator so that then our memory is allocated at the dynamic time or the additional memory is used at the runtime, so that there is no boundation on the there is no boundation on the timing, there is no boundation of the memory, that does not affect or does not affect the performance of the program. A dynamic memory allocator maintains an area of the process virtual memory known as the heap. That is the what is the role of the or how or dynamic memory allocator is used. It maintains an area. It maintains an area means it allocates an area of a process virtual memory, that is known as the heap. So it allocates or it creates a new area, that is known as the heap, for storing the variables or for storing the data at the runtime. So if the question arises how dynamic memory allocator is used, that is used for creating a new area, for storing the data that is known as the heap. Details vary from system to system, but without loss of generality. We will assume that the heap is an area of demand zero memory that begins immediately after the uninitialized BSS area and grows upward, that is toward higher addresses. For each process, the kernel maintains a variable BRK, that is the break that points to the top of the heap. This says a new area can be generated, or a new area is generated by the dynamic memory allocator for storing the data or for storing the variable pointers functions at the runtime. That is done by the dynamic memory allocator. An allocator maintains the heap. Maintains the heap means maintains the storage area as a collection of various size chunks. That is, the area is also divided into multiple chunks. Each block is a contiguous chunk of virtual memory that is either allocated or free. That is either used or that is either free or the used or allocated. An allocated block has an explicitly reserved for use by the application. A free block is available to be allocated. Allocators comes in two basic styles. So this is the diagram that shows the heap area. So this is the heap. That is the area that is used by the virtual memory or that is used by the C programmer whenever there is a huge requirement, whenever there is an extra requirement of the memory at the runtime. So they use the area that is known as the heap, and this is the syntax or this is the diagram that shows what are the contents in the heap. First of all, there is a user stack. Then there is a blank space or the empty space. Then memory mapped reason for shared library. That is how memory mapping is done with the shared library with the shared functions. Then again there is a blank area. Then there is a heap. Heap means the data is stored in the heap memory. That is the blank area. Then uninitialized data, that is the data is not initialized. For example, if I am declaring int n, that is not initialized data. Initialized data means if I am declaring int n equals to 10, that is an initialized data. Then program text, that is a coding part that is written, that is a header file, cout, cin, printf, so that is a program text. And then again there is a blank area. So this is the structure of the heap that is used as a storage area whenever the memory is allocated at the runtime. This says allocators comes in two basic styles. Both style requires the application to explicitly allocate the block. They differ about which entity is responsible for freezing allocated block. So what are the different styles for the allocator? One is explicit allocators. One is implicit allocators. Explicit allocators requires the application to explicitly free any allocated blocks. That is, explicit allocators requires or need the application or maintain the application to free any allocated blocks. For example, the C library function, that is use the malloc. That is, malloc function is used to create the memory, to use the memory, and then allocates the memory, and then the memory is free or the memory is vacant or memory is queued up by using the free function. So two memories is used, that is comes under the explicit allocators. One is your delete, one is your free, one is your malloc. Malloc is used to allocate a memory. Free is used to release the memory or release the content from the memory. For using the malloc, the function that is used is the malloc, that is your malloc function. And for releasing a memory, for emptying the memory, the function that is used is the free function. The new and the delete functions or the calls in C++ are comparable. That is, again, the new function is also used in C, that is the new and the delete. So in C++, two functions are used, new, delete. New is used for allocation, delete is used for deallocation. In the same way, in C, two functions are used. One is malloc, one is free. Malloc is used for allocation, free is used for deallocation. So malloc and new are the same, and the free and the delete are the same. Next, implicit allocators. That requires the allocator to detect an allocated block is no longer being used by the program and then free the block. These are known as the garbage collectors. And the process of automatically freezing unused allocated blocks is known as the garbage collection. So whenever we use the C functions like malloc, calloc, new, delete, free, that we can done manually by calling the function. But whenever there is automatically garbage collection means dump area or the dust area that is automatically collect the data into new section, that is known as the garbage collection, and that comes under the implicit allocator. So these are the three topics or the four topics that is covered in this topic. One is malloc, one is free, one is delete, one is release, or the malloc, new, delete, free. So four functions are generally used for memory allocation or for dynamic memory allocation. Now let's see with the help of PPTs. Chapter number 9, that is virtual memory continued. The topic is dynamic memory management or dynamic memory allocation. These are the contents that is used. Now let's start with the dynamic memory management or the dynamic memory allocation. This says memory allocation is done in C by using the malloc, calloc, realloc, deallocated using the free function. So these are the four functions that is used in the memory allocation in C language only. That is calloc, malloc, realloc, as well as the delete function, sorry, free function to delete the or for deallocating the memory. Then memory allocation in C++. As I told you, two operators are used by two functions are used. One is your new function, one is your delete function. New function is used to allocate the memory, and delete function is used to delete or deallocate the memory. Now let's start with the malloc. This is the syntax for the malloc. That is, there are two arguments that is used. One is the size t, one is simply size. This says, this is the syntax that is used. This says this allocates, that is malloc allocates the size bytes and returns a pointer to the allocated memory. So it allocates the size bytes, that is it identify or it assigns the size bytes and returns a pointer to the allocated memory. So the allocation purpose is used for the bytes and returns a pointer variable. The memory is not cleared. That is cleared by using the free function. Next is the free function. The syntax is using the return type. There is a pointer, that is P. This frees the memory space. That is, this releases the content from the memory pointed to by P. Which must have been returned by a previous call to malloc, calloc, or realloc. That is, it frees the or it releases the memory space that is pointed by the P, and which must be returned by the previous call, that is, which must be used by the previous function, that is the malloc, calloc, reallocate or the realloc. If free has already been called before, undefined behavior occurs. If P is null, no operation is performed. That is, if free function or if free function is used earlier also, then undefined behavior occurs. Next, method to do dynamic storage allocation. That is, what are the method that is used to do or to perform the dynamic storage allocation? First is the best fit method. That is, the best fit method is used, then is your first fit, then the prevention of fragmentation. Then best fit method, so these are the methods to allocate the dynamic or to allocate the memory in the dynamic nature. That is the methods to do or method to perform the dynamic storage allocation. One is your best fit method. that is the method that an area with the m byte is selected where m is the smallest available chunk of contiguous memory equals to or larger than the n. Means area with the m bytes or with the m space is created where m is the smallest chunk, that is the smallest area that is available of the contiguous memory equal to or larger than the n. So that is your best fit. Next, first bit is returns the first chunk that is not randomly picked or that is not used by searching the available chunks or by searching the smallest available. No, it directly returns the first chunk that is encountered containing the n or more number of bytes. This is the main difference. Best fit matlab means it allocates or it defines or it bring out only the smallest available chunk. But in first bit, the first chunk that is available is your first fit method. Then prevention of fragmentation. Next method that is used, a memory manager may allocate chunks that are larger than the requested size if the space remaining is too small to be useful. That is how to prevent or what is the next method that is used to dynamic allocate prevents the fragmentation, that is uses only the one memory, uses cannot use the allocated chunk that are larger than the requested size if the space remaining is too small. Next is your memory managers, that is what is a memory manager, next tool or the next method that is used for the dynamic memory allocation. Then next is memory manager. This returns a chunk to the available space list as soon as they become free and consolidate adjacent area. So it returns the chunks, it returns a chunk to the available space that is available as soon as they become free and consolidate or combine the adjacent area. Then next method that is used is your boundary tracks, that is used to help or that is used as a help to consolidate adjoining chunks of the memory so that fragmentation is avoided. That is consolidate or combines the additional chunk that is available of the free memory. Extra chunks means free memory chunks are available so that fragmentation is avoided. That is done by the boundary tag. So these are the methods for the dynamic allocation or dynamic memory allocation at the runtime. Now, what are the errors or what are the pro or cons that is used in the that is available whenever we allocate the memory at the dynamic time? So first of all, there is a initialization errors, then failing to check return values, then writing to already freed memory. These are the various errors. First of all, there may be initialization error. Suppose I miss n equals to 10, I simply write int n, that is the uninitialized data. So this is also an error. Then failing to check return types, that is it is not in my mind that return type is also checked, that also gives an error. Then writing to already freed memory, that is already freed the memory, or writing that is already used memory, we are writing the same code again in that memory, that also causes the error. Then freezing the same memory multiple times, that is stopping the same memory, or freeze means fix the same memory for computation, for complexity, for multiple times for the same memory only. Then improperly paired memory management functions. For example, if I am doing the memory management, there is no pairing between the memories, like cache memory is not responsible for primary memory. That is also an error, there is an improper paired memory management functions. Then failure to distinguish scalars and the arrays, that is if the array is not declared, if the scalar is not declared, so it is also the error in the dynamic memory allocation. Then improper use of allocation function, that is if I am using the malloc function, C is missing. If I am using the calloc function, C is missing at the end. That is also an error in the memory management system. Now let's start with these errors. That is, what are these errors and what is the meaning of each error? So first of all, there is an initialization error, then failure to check return value. So let's start with one by one. But before going to the next slide, let's take a quick review in the PowerPoint presentation, in the book that is used. So these are the two functions that is used in the C language, that is the malloc and the free function. This says the C standard library functions provides an explicit allocator known as the malloc package. Programs allocates block from the heap by calling the malloc function. That is, programmers uses the or allocates the block from the heap. That is, it allocates the from the free space in the terms of the explicit allocator known as the malloc process or the malloc tag. This is the example for malloc, that is hash include std library dot h, that is the standard library dot h. Then there is a pointer that is used, that is void malloc size t size, the same example that we have studied with the help of the PPTs. That is how malloc function is used, by using the two arguments. One is a simple argument that is using the size, one is your pointer argument, one is your pointer variable. The malloc function returns a pointer to a block of memory. This says returns ptr to allocated block if okay, null if an error. That is, it returns the ptr, it returns the pointer to the allocated block if the everything is gone well, otherwise it gives an error. So this returns a pointer to a block of memory of at least size bytes that is suitably aligned for any kind of data object that might be contained in the block. On the Unix system that are familiar with, malloc returns a block that is assigned or aligned to an 8 byte boundary. Next, how big is a word? That is, how a word is used, or how big is a word that is a collection of various bytes. So in simple terms, till now we have studied there are four functions that is used for the dynamic memory allocation: new, delete, malloc, free. Malloc and free are used in the C language, and the new and the delete are used in the C++ language. This says if malloc function encounters a problem, then it returns a null and sets the error number. It does not initialize the memory it returns. Dynamic memory allocators such as malloc can allocate or deallocate the heap memory explicitly by using the mmap and the munmap function, or they can use the sbreak function. So one is your sbreak function that grows or shrink the heap by adding the increment to the kernel's break pointer. And one is your free function that is used to deallocate the block by using the free function. The PTR argument must point to the beginning of an allocated block that was obtained from the malloc, calloc or realloc. So this is the PTR argument that point to the beginning of the allocated block. That is, it deallocates the memory, reaches the cursor to the next block, to the first argument, to the PTR function, to the beginning of the allocated block if it was defined, that was defined from the malloc function. Figure 34 shows an implementation of malloc and free byte manage a small heap of 16 words in a C program. This is the allocating and freezing the block with the free and the with the malloc and the free function. First of all, there is a P1, that is only there is a one process that is used the malloc function. So now this is the memory that is allocated at the runtime for process 1. So figure number A, that is, this shows that P1 process is coming at the runtime and the malloc function is used for allocating the memory. that is 4 into size of n, that is size of function is used for declaring or for initializing the variable. Then two processes are used, that is p2. Now p2 equals to malloc 5 into size of n. So why this is 4, this is 5? Because this uses the 4 blocks and this uses the 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This uses the 5 block, so that is 5 into size of n. Again, there is a 6 block, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then 6 size into size of, oh sorry, 6 into size of int. Now, free the memory or free the space for the P2. So this is the best example for the malloc and the calloc. Sorry, malloc and the free. So malloc is used for allocating at the runtime for different processes. And free is used for deallocating. Now, after allocating the P1, P2, P3 to the memory, now uses the free function for releasing or deallocating the memory. This is free P2 that deallocates the memory for the P2 process. Next is your allocation of the P4, that is at the runtime 2 bytes are reserved, 2 int bytes, that is the 4 bytes, because int takes 2 bytes, so 4 bytes are reserved for the P4. Now let's see, P4 is the vacant space. Now P4 arrives over here only, not goes beyond the P3. Why? Because the data is available or the free size or the free block is available over here only. So this is P4 is used for allocating, or the malloc function is used for allocating for the P4 process in place of the P2. Why? Because P2 has already released by using the free function of the P2. This is allocating and freeing the blocks with malloc and free. Each square corresponds to a word, each heavy rectangle corresponds to a block. Allocated blocks are shared, that I showed you. Padded regions of allocated blocks are shaded with strips. Free blocks are unshaped, unshaded. Heap address increases from left to the right. So this is the explanation of the figure. Now let's see. The same lines are used. Figure 34A, in which the program asks for a 4-word block. Malloc respond by carving out a 4-word block from front end on the block and return a pointer and so on that I told you. And the program requests a 5-block memory, 6-block memory, and so on that I told you. So that is the example. This is the example of the this diagram. Now, why we are using the dynamic memory allocation? The main advantage is that it allocates the memory at the runtime, so that if there is a need at the runtime, because we cannot predict in the beginning that how much memory is needed. Everything is possible whenever we are using the practical approach. And for any programming, the practical approach is that whenever we are executing any program. So this provides a facility that at the runtime, whenever there is a requirement, whenever we are practically using the program, it allocates the memory at the runtime. So this is the best advantage. That's why we are using the dynamic memory allocation. This is the main important reason why we are using the dynamic memory allocation is that often they do not know the sizes of the certain data structure until the program actually runs. That it does not know, or it do not know the sizes or the size of the various data structure until the program actually runs. As I told you, we cannot predict in the beginning. For example, this is the example that, as I told you, this is the example. The simplest approach is to define the array statically with some hard-coded minimum array size. Allocating array with hard source size like this is often a bad idea. So this gives an example that except the dynamic memory allocation, what are the tools available, what are the methods available. So if I'm supposed to add that, if I'm using the allocating memory by using the arrays, that is not in use. Why? If I'm allocating, or if I'm defining the array of 15 bytes, let's example, and at the time of running the program, executing the program, if there is a requirement, that if I'm using the 16 bit. So how is that possible? No, is it not possible if there is no facility for the dynamic allocation, for the dynamic memory allocation? A better approach is to allocate the array dynamically at the runtime, the same way after the value of n become knowns. With this approach, the minimum or the maximum size of the array is limited only by the amount of available virtual memory. It is useful that is dynamic memory allocation is useful and important programming technique. Now, allocator requirements and the goal. Explicit allocators, that is a malloc and the free function, is required or must operate within some rather stringent constraint. That is, it handles the arbitrary. It means the malloc and the calloc function handles the arbitrary request sequence, making the immediate response to the request using only the heap. Aligning the block. So these are the multiple advantages why we are using, or these are the various goals why we are using the dynamic memory allocation by using the malloc and the free program. Now let's see with the help of PPTs what are the errors that is used. One is initialization error. Most C programs uses malloc function to allocate blocks of the memory. A common error is that is assuming that malloc zeros memory. That is, malloc is used for zeros the memory. Then initializing large blocks of memory can impact performance and is not always necessary. That is, it always impact the performance if there is an initialization of the large memory or large block of the memory. Programmers have to utilize or initialize memory using memory set or by calling the calloc function which zeros the memory. So programmer have the facility to initialize the memory for releasing the memory using the memory set function or by calling the calloc function. Now, next is error is failing to check the return values. Memory is a limited resource, as I told you, and can be exhausted. Memory allocation function reports status back to the caller. Then virtual alloc returns a null. That is, the virtual allocation returns a null if there is any error. Microsoft Office, Microsoft Foundation class library, that is MSC operator, new throws C memory exception. Then heap alloc may returns the null or raises a structured exception. Then the application programmer should determine whether an error has encountered or not, occurred or not, or handle the errors in an appropriate manner or not. That is, the failing to check the return values. Then how to check the return codes from the malloc function. That is, how we are using the malloc function. This is the example of C language using the pointer variable. This is the pointer variable that is used, and align the value of the malloc function, that is how much space is required, by using the size of operator int and elements wanted. That is, how many elements are wanted, that capacity, that area, that bytes must be stored to the I underscore pointer. Now if I underscore pointer is not equals to null, that is not equals to the zero, then IPTR I equals to I. That is, using the variable or using the properties or using the array, that is the IPTR I equals to I. So initializing first of all 0, then I is equal to 0, then 1, I equals to 1. So it will be incremented 1 by 1, else could not get the memory recovery. This is the example that shows how to check the return codes from the malloc function, that is how to get the values from the malloc function. Then next is incorrect use of the standard new operator. That is, how to use incorrectly, or what is the use of incorrect use of standard new operator. This is int ip equals to new int if ip, else will never execute. References referencing freed memory. This is also an error. That is, once memory has been freed, that is, the memory has been deallocated, it is still possible to read or write from its location if the memory pointer has not been set to the null. So it is a mandatory condition to always set the pointer to the null whenever we freed the memory, whenever we deallocate the memory. An example of this programming error is this one. 4, p equals to head, p is not equals to null. That is, initializing the value as p equals to head, the condition is that p is not equals to the null, that is not equals to the 0. Then p equals to p next, that is the next pointer or the next variable that is used, that is also stored in the p. So this is the value that is incremented. Then free the function. Now, what is the error and what is the solution for this error? This says, reading from already freed memory almost always succeed without a memory fault, while the memory is usually not erased by call to free. That is, do not use the free function whenever there is a memory that is usually not erased by the call to the free. If a memory that has not been allocated, writing to a free chunk may overwrite and corrupt the data structure. So these are the multiple errors that is facing whenever we use the free function. Now, next is free memory multiple times. Suppose I free the memory one time, that is okay. But if I freed the memory multiple times, that is also an error that is error that is used in any programming language, in any explicit allocators. This says, freeing the same memory chunk more than one is also dangerous because it can corrupt the data structure. Data structure means it can corrupt the structure of the data or the files, data file that is available in the memory. This is example in C language. First of all, use the malloc function, returns the values in bytes into going to the or sent to the X. Now, free the X, that is free the memory, that is X. Then allocate the memory or using the malloc function and store the data in the Y. Then free the X. Means here, the logically it is freed the Y, but by mistaken, by manual error, it is free the X. So this is the very dangerous. This affects the data structure of the program. This is the dwelling data structures. The same data structure is freed multiple times. It is less dangerous to leak the memory than to free the memory twice. Now, next error is that improperly paired memory management function. That is, improperly paired means improper pair is used for the memory management functions. This says memory management functions must be properly paired. If new is used to obtain the storage, delete should be used to free. That is, if new function is used to use the storage or to allocate the memory, then it is a mandatory condition that delete function is used to free. Not necessary or not there is a, if for example, if I'm using the C and the C++ both at the same time, and if I'm confused, if I'm using new function to allocate the memory, but if I'm using the free function along with the new function for releasing the memory, why this gives an error? Why? Because in C there is a different function, that is malloc and the free. In C++ there is a different function, that is new and the delete. And if I mesh up or if I combine these functions, that also gives an error. That is your improper paired memory management functions. This is used if malloc is used, then free should be used. If new is used, then delete is a bad practice. This is the example of the impaired memory management function. This is new is used, in this there is a delete is used. That is the wrong. Free is also wrong. Why? Because if there is a malloc, then I'm using the free. Failure to distinguish scalars and the arrays. This is also an error. That is it, failure to differentiate between the scalars and the arrays. This is the scalar, that is the new, this is the array. Then next is improper use of the allocation function. This is the improper use, that is a zero, that is it does not return the null value. Next is your Dugly memory allocator. Now let's see with the help of the book. This is the same, the allocating the array with the hard coded size is often a bad area, the same example. Now allocator requirement and the goals, that what is their requirement, that handles the request sequences. Now next is your fragmentation. What is a fragmentation? That is a utilization or dividing the memory into multiple parts, known as fragmentation. This is this topic is covered after the break. So let's take a quick break, or the 5 to 10 minutes break, then come back and starting with the next topic, that is your fragmentation. So let's take 5 to 10 minutes break and then come back. Now let's start with the next topic, that is fragmentation. So come back from the break, start with the next topic, that is fragmentation. The primary cause or the primary impact or the primary measure, or we can say cause of the poor heap utilization, is a phenomenon known as the fragmentation, which occurs when otherwise unused memory is not available to satisfy the allocate request. So this is the main cause, this is the main root why there is a poor heap utilization phenomenon. That is why not every program is using the heap utilization, why not every program is using the heap. That is the main motto is that the main phenomenon is that fragmentation, which occurs when otherwise unused memory is not available to satisfy the allocated resources. There are two types of fragmentation that is used. One is internal, one is external. Internal occurs when an allocated block is larger than the payload. That is the allocated block that is used, or the allocated block is more or the larger than the payload that is used. This might happen for a number of reasons. For example, the implementation of an allocator might impose a minimum size on allocated blocks that is larger than some requested payload, or the allocator might increase the block size in order to satisfy the alignment constraint. External fragmentation occurs, that is the next part, that is the external fragmentation that occurs when there is enough aggregate free memory to satisfy an allocate request. That is, this occurs whenever there is a free allocate memory, whenever there is a free aggregate free memory that is used to satisfy an allocated request, but no single free space is large enough to handle the request. This is shown with the help of the figure, that is 34E, 34B. This is the figure. This is the figure, that is the 34B. This is used for the first part, that is your external fragmentation. 34E is used for the this is used for the internal fragmentation, that is internally it is used. This is the external fragmentation, that is in place of P2, the P4 is used. Now, external fragmentation is much more difficult to quantify than the internal fragmentation. Why? Because it depends not only on the pattern of the previous request, but also the allocator implementation, but also on the routine of the future request. That is, it is also taken care of the future expect. That is why external fragmentation is more difficult, more tedious to handle than the internal fragmentation. This says, since external fragmentation is difficult to quantify and impossible to predict, allocators typically employ heuristic approach that attempt to maintain small number of large free blocks rather than the large number of smaller free blocks. That is, it contains or it maintains the small number of larger blocks. That is, the large block is used, but there are less number of the large blocks, rather than maintaining the small block for the large number. Why? Because the fragmentation is more easier, or the external fragmentation is very difficult as compared to the internal fragmentation. Now, what are the implementation issues? That is, whenever we implement the dynamic allocation, dynamic memory allocation, what are the implementation issues that is used? The simplest imaginary allocator would organize the heap as a large array of bytes and a pointer p that initially points to the first byte of the array. To allocate the size byte, malloc would save the current value of p on the stack, increment the p, return the old value of p to the caller. So these are the implementation issues. Free would simply return to the caller without doing anything. That is, the free function is not doing anything and only returns the memory or returns the caller without doing the anything. So these are the implementation issues that is used. First of all, these are the consideration that we must consider by allocating the memory at the runtime. The first issue, that is free block organization. How do we keep track of the free block? That is, how we see the free block, or how we can keep the track of the free block that is available in the memory. Next, placement. That is, how do we choose an appropriate free block in which to place a newly allocated block? That is the placement. Next, splitting. After we place a newly allocated block in some free block, what do we do with the remainder of the free block? That is, whenever there is a free block that is used, whenever there is a new memory that is available, then what do we do with the remainder of the free block, that is the left blocks. Next, coalescing, that what can we do with the block that have just been freed? That is the implementation issues. These are the answer that is used, or these are the question that is available whenever there is a free block, whenever there is a allocated block. Then next is implicit free list. That is, what are the free list or the implicit free list that is available? This says any practical allocator needs some data structure that allows it to distinguish block boundaries and to distinguish between allocated and the free blocks. Most allocators embedded this information in the block themselves. One simple approach is shown in the figure 25 or 35. This is the format of the simple free block. That is the block size that is written, or this return a pointer to the payload. This is the payload that is the allocated block only. In this case, a block consists of one word header, the payload, and possibly some additionally padding. The header encodes the block size as well as whether the block is allocated or free. This is the example how we can organize with the implicit free list. So this is the unused data, this is the used data, this is the used data, this is the used data, this is used. That is your double word align. That is the start of the heap. We call this organization as an implicit free list because the free blocks are linked implicitly by the size field in the headers. Next is placing the allocated blocks. So what are the methods that how we can place the allocated block? That is done by the placement policy. So one important tool technique that is used, or the that is used for the how we can place the allocated block, that is done by or determined by the placement policy. And that placement policy includes various parts, like as I told you, first fit, best fit, and the next fit. Now let's see with the help of PPTs. This is the allocation, how allocation is done. This says first fit searches the free list from the beginning and chooses the first free block that fits. So as the name advises, first fit. So it starts from the beginning and choose the best fit that is available for that block, or that is the block is best suited in which fit that is the first fit that is available. So fit it the data in the first block. So this says and chooses the first free block that fits the data or that fits the block. Next bit is similar to the first bit, but instead of starting each search at the beginning, it starts each search where the previous search left off. Suppose if there is a block of the 15 figures or the 15 bytes, and if I'm searching the content at the previous stage at the 6th, and if I'm using the next bit, so it starts searching from the 7th one, not from the beginning. That's the main difference between the first bit and the next bit. The first bit start from the beginning only, and the next bit start from the point where we can left from the for the previous organization or the for the previous searching. Next is your best fit that examines every free block and chooses the free block with the smallest size that fits. So it examines every free block and it chooses the best size or the best block that suits the words. It means it chooses that block or that file or the that free block in which we can fit our data very effectively. That is, there is no wastage of resources, there is no wastage of time for fetching the data. So these are the three methods, three placement policies, how we can place the allocated or how we can place the block in the different allocated blocks. An advantage of first fit is that it tends to retain large free blocks at the end of the list. That is, the main advantage is that it tends to retain the large free blocks at the end of the list. A disadvantage is that it tends to leave the splinters of some or small free blocks. Now, how to split the free blocks? That is, how to divide the free blocks into multiple parts. This is the next one. That is, once the allocator has allocated the free block with the help of the placement policies like first fit, next fit, best fit, it must make another policy decision about how much of the free block to allocate. One option is to use the entire free block. Another simple and the main disadvantage is that it introduces the internal fragmentation. That is, the simplest method is that simply use the entire free block, but the disadvantage is that it introduces the internal fragmentation. If the placement policy tend to produce good fits, the additional internal fragmentation might be acceptable. But if the fit is not good, then the allocator usually opt to split the free block into multiple parts. So that is dividing the block into multiple parts, that is done by the splitting the block. This is the example how to split a free block to satisfy a three-word allocation request. This is the splitting part. One is used, another one, then this is also used. Allocated blocks are shaded. This is the shaded portion. Free blocks are unshaded, that is the white portion. Headers are labeled with the size and the bytes. This is the size and the bytes. So this, the same three word is divided into multiple parts. One is this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, to this one. So this is how we can split the parts into multiple free blocks. Now, how to get the additional heap memory? Now, there is a requirement that choosing the additional heap memory in excess of the heap memory that is provided by the virtual memory. This says, what happens if the allocator is unable to find a fit for the requested block? That is, if the allocator, that is either internal or the external, find it difficult to fit for the requested block. One option is to try or to create some larger free blocks by merging free blocks that are physically adjacent in memory. That is, one solution is that create the large free block by merging the free blocks that are physically available in the memory. However, if this does not yield a sufficiently large block, or if the free blocks are already maximally coalesced, then the allocator asks the for asking heap memory by calling the SBRK function, that is your S break function. The allocator transform the additional memory into the large one, so on so on. This is the example of the false fragmentation. Then how to call async free blocks, that is how to clutter the free blocks together. This says when the allocator frees an allocated block. That is whenever we use the free function to free the allocated block, that is the allocator frees an allocated block, there might be other free blocks that are adjacent to the newly freed block. That is, if I free the block, for example, 6, and 7th is also a free block that is adjacent to the 6. So that can also be used as a free block, and that phenomenon is known as the false fragmentation, where there is a lot of available free memory chopped into the small unusable free blocks. So that is coalescing free blocks means that the free block that is adjacent to the free block that freed the memory by using the free function, that is also used as the free one and used for the memory location. This says as a result, a subsequent request for a payload of 4 words and would fail even though the aggregate size of 2 blocks is large enough to satisfy the request. To combat false fragmentation, any practical allocator must merge adjacent free block in a process known as the coalescing. That is dividing, or that is combining or merging the free blocks into one another that is adjacent. That process is known as the coalescing. This raises an important policy decision about what to perform, when to perform the coalescing. This can opt for the immediate coalescing by merging any adjacent block each time a block is freed. So there are two types of coalescing also. One is immediate, one is deferred. Deferred means that is after some times. Immediate means that is straightforward and can be performed in constant time with some request pattern that it can introduce a form of thrashing. Now, how to coalescing with the boundary values or the boundary tags? Now, next is coalescing with the boundary tags. How does an allocator implement the coalescing? Let us refer to the block we want to free as a current block. Then coalescing the next free block is straightforward and efficient. The header of the current block points to the header of the next block. This says that how to use the coalescing with the boundary tags. The main reason is that every tag, every block of the memory is attached with one another. That is, the next block is attached with the previous block by using a pointer variable. As I told you, pointer is an address variable that stores the address of the another variable. So if I'm using the boundary tag, if I'm using the coalescing, that is a free memory that is attached to the next one, that is related to the next free memory by using the address, by using the pointer. So this says coalescing the next free block in is a straightforward and efficient. The header of the current block points to the header of the next block, which can be checked to determine if the next block is free or not. If so, its size is simply added to the size of the current header and the blocks are coalesced in the constant time. but how would we collapse the previous block? That is how we can collide, or how we can merge the previous block, because the address that is related is to the next one but not with the previous one. The only option is that to search the entire list, remembering the location until we reach the current block. So there is no direct procedure. Simply remember and manually search the content and then free the memory or merges the free spaces. This is the format of the heap block that uses a boundary tag. There is a block size, there is a payload, there is a padding, there is a block size. This says consider all the cases that can exist when the allocator frees the current block. The previous and the next blocks are both allocated. So these are the conditions, or these are the scenarios where the allocator, that is the allocation mechanism, free the current block. Whenever there is a previous and the next blocks are both allocated, whenever there is a previous block is allocated and the next block is free, whenever there is a previous block is free and the next block is allocated, means one is free, one is allocated, or both are allocated, that's then also we can use. Why? The main reason is that one block is attached to the next block via the address, via the reference that attaches the two blocks. The fourth point says the previous and the next blocks are both free. In that condition also, that the area is free, that is known as the, or that is done by the address variable. Figure 40 shows how we could coalesce each of the four cases. This is the figure 14. These are the cases. The first case is that both are free. This is the free, this will be allocated. This say this is not free, this is free. One is free, one is not free, so that is also allocated. Case 3, one is free, one is not free, that is also allocated. One is free, one is not free, or both are allocated, that is also case 4. This is the previous and the next allocated. This is the previous and the next. Previous allocated, next free, this is the allocated, this is the free. Case 3, previous free, this is the free, sorry, this is the free and this is the allocated. Case 4, next and the previous, both are free. Now, putting it together, implementing a simple allocator, that is, building an allocator is a challenging task. The design space is large with a numerous alternative for the block format and the free list format, as well as placement, splitting, coalescing policy. Another challenge is that you are often forced to program outside the safe, familiar confines of the type system, relying on the error-prone pointer, casting and pointer arithmetic that is typical of low-level system programming. So this says how to implement a simple allocator so that allocation is done in a simplest way. While allocators do not require enormous amount of code, they are subtle and they are unforgiving. Students familiar with the high level languages such as C++, Java often hit a conceptual wall when they encounter this style of programming. The first allocator that is used is the general allocator design. Our allocator uses a model of the memory system provided by the memory library.c package. So this is the first allocator, that is a simple allocator that is used, that is a general allocator design. These are the various examples in the C language. This is the memory system model. Next is basic constraint and macros for manipulating the free list. That is, what are the constraint and what are the macros that is used for manipulating, for performing the operations on the free list. Figure 43 shows basic constraint and macros that is used, that we will use throughout the allocator code. Line 24 defines some basic constraint. Now let's see figure 43. This figure 43, these are the lines that is used, that is a word and the header, footer size. in bytes. That defines the word size, that is a 4 by default. Then hash defined d size, that is a double word size, that is also a 8. Then hash defined chunk size, that is one is right shifted by the 12, that is extended the heap or extend the heap by this amount, that is in bytes. Then this is the use for the maximum and the minimum, that is for defining the maximum value and the minimum value. This is used for the pack, this is used for the get, this is used for the read and write, that is get means read, put means write. This is used for getting the or reading the size and the allocated fields. Then next is your given block by computing the address, that is strp, ftrp, next blkp, previous blkp. Then how to create the initial field list. These are the constraints and the macros. Now let's see. This is the same line 2 to 4 defines some basic size constraint, that is the size of the words and the double words. In the same way, size of the initial free block and the default, that is the chunk size. The pack macro combines a size and an allocate bit and returns a value that can be stored in a header or footer. Then get size, get alloc macros, strp, ftrp macros, previous block. Then how to create the initial free list. Before calling nmalloc or nmfree, the application must initialize the heap by calling the niminit function. That is the this is the way how we can create the initial free list. The niminit function gets 4 words from the memory system and initializes them to create a free empty or create the free empty free list, that is line 4 to 10. This is used for empty list, that is from line, that is a chunk, that is a define 9 10. This is a 4 to 10. This is used for the empty list. This is the list that is used by break. This is the put, means inserting the value, again put. Then next is how to what is freeing and coalescing the blocks. An application frees a previously allocated block by calling the nmfree function or the mmfree function, that is a memory free function. So whenever we want to free the block, that is done by calling the mmfree function. And whenever we are coalescing the blocks, that is done by using the coalescer helper function. This is known as the coalesce helper function, is the straightforward implementation of the 4 cases. Then how to allocate the blocks, that is done by the mmalloc. So these are the various functions that is used for freeing, for coalescing. These are the examples for freeing, coalescing. This is also the example for allocation a block. Now how to explicit the free blocks. This is the example of the free blocks. The implicit free list provides us with the simplest way, some basic allocator concepts. However, because block allocation time is linear in the total amount of heap blocks, the implicit free list is not appropriate for a general purpose allocator. A better approach is to organize the free block into some form of explicit data structure. Since by definition the body of a free block is not needed by the program, the pointer that implement the data structure can be stored within the bodies of the free block. So one of the approach that is used for the explicit free list is the last in first out. That is the last block that is inserted is the first block that is pop up, that is pop out, that is using the LIFO concept. Next is how to segregate the free list, that is how to divide the main list into multiple parts. A popular approach for reducing the allocation time is generally known as a segregated storage to maintain multiple free list where each list holds block that are roughly the same space. That is simply combining the or dividing the space into multiple parts. Then how to segregate the fits? What is a buddy system? It is a special case of segregated fits where each size class is a power of 2. Now, next is your garbage collection. That is the next function that the explicit allocator is used. So till now we have discussed the dynamic memory allocation by using the only implicit allocator but not using the explicit allocator. The next topic, that is a tomorrow's topic, that is a garbage collection, is a topic that is using the explicit allocator. That is a tomorrow's topic. So let's stop over here only. In the next class, that is in the tomorrow's class, I will be starting your next topic, that is a garbage collection. So now, if you have any doubts, then please text the doubts and I will answer you. So that's all for today's session. Thank you so much everyone for listening me. So thanks a lot everyone.